My topic is the story behind oral ulcers, and I'll be talking on Behçet's disease, also known as Behçet's syndrome, and it's prevalent along the ancient Silk Route, spanning from Far East, China and Japan to Mediterranean region, and it includes Middle East countries. And I have seen only few patients of Behçet's during past few years, and so I thought it's worth sharing my experience with you, and I'll discuss few case histories in brief, and we'll touch upon management as well. So it's most prevalent in Turkey, and it's around 80 to 370 per 100,000 patients, and it's also seen in to a lesser degree in Japan, Korea, China, and Middle East countries, Iran, Iraq, and Saudi Arabia. And it's rare in Northern America and Northern Europe. And in here at in Sri Lanka, at National Hospital, so we have seen in our department at Department of Rheumatology and Rehabilitation General, we have registered new patients of 150 RA patients and SLE 60, but we have seen only 6 patients with Behçet's. So etiology of Behçet's is not known, but there's a strong hereditary factor, and environmental factors can trigger, like bacterial infections or viral infection. And there's strong association with HLA-B51 with the disease, as well as the severity of the disease. When we consider the HLA-B27 gene distribution, so it strongly correlates the disease distribution. But 1/3 of patients of Behçet's do not have HLA-B51. So, as you know, it's a vasculitis, but peculiar thing about Behçet's is it affects vessels of all sizes, small, medium, and large, and veins as well. And there are also manifestations in skin, ocular manifestations, joints, gastrointestinal, as well as CNS manifestation.
Sorry.
There are no laboratory markers, so detailed clinical evaluation, history and examination is important to make the diagnosis. So there are diagnostic criteria and international study group criteria published in 1990, so that when there are recurrent oral ulcers, if there are two other things, either genital ulcers, skin lesions like including erythema nodosum, pseudofolliculitis, and acne-like lesions, and or ocular lesions or pathology. If two of these things are positive with history of recurrent oral ulcers, according to this ICG criteria, we can make the diagnosis. But when we mean like recurrent oral ulcers, at least 3 times per year line. So these are the widespread, the criteria which are used widespread. But there are other international criteria for Behçet's disease published in 2006. For that, oral ulcers are not mandatory. And here, with this criteria, need 3 marks to diagnose. And genital ulcers and ocular involvement carry, either genital ulcers or ocular involvement carry 2 marks, and vasculitis also included. So either skin lesions, pathology, or vascular lesions carries 1 mark. So if there are 3 marks, we can make the diagnosis. Here sensitivity is more, but still the international study group criteria used widely. So we talk about pathology. So pathology is this abnormal reaction to a needle prick. So from history, we can ask whether there is any papule formation at the site of venipuncture. So that's also can be taken as positive pathology, and it's not very specific to vegets, but it's very important to make the diagnosis. And when we, how do we check pathology is by inserting a sterile needle obliquely into the skin up to up to a few millimeters, and there will be nodule formation within 24 to 48 hours if there is positive pathology. But pathology also not positive in everybody, even in endemic areas, it's only 50 to 75% of patients are positive for pathology. But it's rarer in Northern America and Europe, where the it's not prevalent. So my first patient, so he came to our he was referred from medical board to our clinic only last October. So he came by wheelchair due to pain and swelling of his knee, and he couldn't walk due to that. It was going on for 4 weeks, and he also had some shoulder pain at the beginning, but it resolved within about 1 to 2 weeks. But 3 years ago, there's history of recurrent elbow arthritis, and at that time his uric acid was high. It was 8.5 millimoles per liter, and ESR was high, and CRP also were high. And at that time, diagnosis of gout was made, and patient was advised to stop alcohol and to avoid red meat. And after 2 weeks of NSAIDs, so he got better. And for 3 years, there were no joint symptoms. So, but there's history of oral ulcers. Painful mouth sores going on for 4 years. And in the meantime, he had genital ulcers also of same duration. And when he came this time, there were small, like 0.5 millimeter size pustules were there over the trunk, 2 to 3 pustules over the trunk. And he also had history of pathology. So he noticed small papule formation at venipuncture site. And he didn't have constitution symptoms, no fever, no weight loss, nothing. So he has, so I think you can appreciate there's one prominent ulcer on the side of the tongue. So usually these ulcers can be either single or multiple, and usually shallow ulcers with a yellowish necrotic base, and there can be reddish margin, well demarcated margin. And he was getting multiple oral ulcers. And but they usually can get ulcers over the palate, tongue, or the lips, but not in the outer aspect of the lips. So he also was having genital ulcers, multiple genital ulcers, painful, and a scarring of a scarred penile ulcer as well. So his white cell count was high with neutrophil leukocytosis. And this time also ESR was 96, CRP also was high, and uric acid was normal. And STD screening was done, retroviral screen and other things were negative, but there was positive herpes simplex 1, IgG1, and herpes simplex 2 was negative. And previous diagnosis of gout, the aspiration of joint fluid be sent to look for crystals, and crystals were negative. And you have to remember that if you send to a place where there's no polarized microscope or similar facilities, so they will report as no crystals, but this under polarized microscope. So we made the diagnosis of Becher's, and also ocular screen was done. It was negative, and with colchicine 0.5 milligram twice a day, his knee pain was resolved within 2 days, but he was getting some genital ulcers while on colchicine, and with local steroid application, he was okay, and still he's on colchicine 0.5 milligram twice a day. Second patient, she was a 50-year-old female. She presented with episodic knee arthritis, which was going on for 3 years, and her ESR CRP also were very high, and she also presented with fever. And each time he was treated with IV antibiotics and arthrotomy as well as for culture negative septic arthritis. But there's history of oral ulcers going on for 5 years. She also had genital ulcers, usually get vulval ulcers. And these genital ulcers are, there's less tendency to recur. And at that time, so we didn't have colchicine at the government hospital, government sector. So we started her on azathioprine, and still she is followed up in our clinic, and there are no subsequent episodes of arthritis. So arthritis in wedges, so differential diagnosis can be, as in these two patients, can be gout or even septic arthritis, because they come with painful arthritis and having elevated inflammatory markers. So in arthritis, gout is typically non-erosive and usually oligo monoarthritis, and in usual involves large joints. This episode usually lasts 1 to 2 weeks, like, but it may last longer, even 6 weeks. And ESR CRP can be quite high, like in this patient, and colchicine is the drug of choice. If there's resistance, we can use steroids or azathioprine. Third patient. So she's an 18-year-old female. She came to us 1 year ago. Initially, she got admitted to a teaching hospital with history of acne-like lesions over the face, chest, and buttocks as well. Usually, Behçet's disease, acne-like lesions can be seen in unusual places as well, like in buttocks. So she had oral ulcers, but there were no genital ulcers. And her pathology also was positive. She also noticed papule formation at many puncture sites. And in the past, she had skin nodules and the biopsy proven as paniculitis, reported as paniculitis. And the diagnosis of Behçet's was made at the teaching hospital. And she was treated with IV antibiotics, and she got better with IV antibiotics. And at that time, CTPA was done to exclude pulmonary aneurysm. And she didn't like to be on steroids. At that time also, they have discussed that to start steroids. So she is a girl who didn't want to start steroids. So she came to us. And so we started her own colchicine, and she was on azathioprine as well. And so she was doing okay for last 1 year, and somehow colchicine was stopped few months ago, and 6 weeks ago colchicine was stopped, and then again she was getting fever, high fever. It was going on for about 3 weeks, and she came back at the end of December. Last December with recurrent oral ulcers, and she was getting pustular skin lesions also. This is one of this skin lesion. It's also called pseudo folliculitis she was having. So actually these lesions can be, may not be sterile. So in addition, the other complaint was, other than fever and the skin lesions, mucocutaneous lesion, she was having pain in left side of the neck, and there was swelling as well. So we wanted to get done Doppler scan on arrival to the clinic. So we got Doppler scan done. So actually it showed evidence of vasculitis with thickening of intima and media. So hers also ESR was high, 122, CRP also was 168. And so we got her admitted to medical ward, and started on methylprednisolone IV pulses, and followed by oral steroid, but she didn't want to have high dose of steroid, so we had to start only 20 milligram daily. So she has these skin lesions, acne, and this like lumpy skin lesion over the forehead, and these skin lesions clear after 2 weeks of steroid, but her but her neck pain also was less. Sorry about this change. So, but still the repeat Doppler scan showed thickening and evidence of vasculitis of common carotid artery. ESR and CRP has come down, but neck pain was persistent. So due to these persistent vasculitic changes, we wanted whether to start on cyclophosphamide or whether there's need for TNF inhibitors. And so because she asked what are the side effects of cyclophosphamide, because she didn't want even to continue steroids, and obviously so she didn't like to have cyclophosphamide. So we were thinking whether to start on infliximab, then we referred to chest physician for latent TB screening. Arterial involvement with Behçet's vasculitis can lead to hemorrhages, aneurysm, or thrombosis. And it involves commonly carotids, pulmonary, aorta, and iliac and femoral popliteal arteries. It's also commoner in women. And pulmonary arterial aneurysm usually treated with IV methylprednisolone and monthly IV cyclophosphamide pulses. And in refractory patients, we can start on infliximab. So fourth patient, he's a 16-year-old boy, and he presented to a medical presented to ETU with almost collapse situation, and he had fever for about 3 weeks, and had vomiting and faintishness for 1 day, and because of this collapse situation, so he was transferred to ICU. And they are actually initial differential diagnosis included dengue as well. But IVC was not compressible, and ultrasound scan showed extensive thrombosis of inferior vena cava. And so he also had recurrent oral ulcers since 9 years of age, and had scrotal ulcers two years ago, and erythematosum like skin lesions as well. So he was seen by dermatologist, and he's from Batticolo, and he was seen by dermatologist and has been started on dapsone and prednisolone. So while on dapsone and prednisolone 10 milligram MANE only, he developed this. And 1 year ago, he also had one episode of altered level of consciousness. And at that time, MRI brain had been done and it was normal. So his white cell count was very high, 40,000 with neutrophil leukocytosis, and liver functions were deranged with elevated liver transaminases and elevated INR and APTT, and urine output was low and serum creatinine was little high. And this is the CCT showing extensive inferior vena cava thrombosis up to renal artery, origin of renal arteries. And 2D echo also showed large atrial, right atrial thrombus. So because this thrombosis, there's need for anticoagulation. So CTPA was also done, and there were no pulmonary aneurysms. And patient was started on IV methylprednisolone 1 gram, and continued almost 5 days. Then in severe vasculitis in Behçet, so we can continue even 1 week of 1 gram IV methylprednisolone, and after methylprednisolone pulses converted to oral prednisolone, and after excluding pulmonary aneurysms, he was started on enoxaparin as well. And about 2 weeks later, while on prednisolone, there was partial recanalization. So initially we couldn't start cyclophosphamide because of high liver transaminases, but when it came to a reasonable level, so we suggested to start IV cyclophosphamide, and we have completed 3 pulses of 15 milligram per kg. And after 1 month, so there was this persistent atrial thrombus. So actually, initially after trying azathioprine, so it was not working. Patient was having low counts, so we started on infliximab. So month later, the atrial thrombus was not there, and so we could stop warfarin as well after disappearance of the thrombus, and still the patient is on 8 week infliximab, but while on infliximab, he is getting occasional oral ulcer. Otherwise, he is okay. And to talk about venous thrombosis in Behçet's, it's due to endothelial inflammation. It's due to inflammation. It's not due to increased coagulability. So aggressive immunosuppression is the treatment of choice. And anticoagulation, not contraindicated. But after exclusion of pulmonary hemorrhage, pulmonary aneurysm, after pulmonary artery aneurysms, we can start on anticoagulation. And but TNF inhibitors causes rapid resolution of thrombosis. So my fifth patient, he's a 30-year-old soldier. So he had recurrent oral ulcers for 3 years and had genital ulcers at the beginning. And when he presented with eye mold, he had been diagnosed as Behçet's. But he was on not followed up at rheumatology, and he was followed up with on azathioprine and prednisolone local drops for almost 1 year. And then one day he was referred to our clinic, and when we saw the patient, he was almost blind in one eye and there's poor vision in the other eye. So we just started infliximab. So he got some improvement. So he's from Monaragal and he defaulted, and now he wants to come back to the clinic to get infliximab because there was some improvement. And inside the house he can walk and do his things. So sixth patient is a 25-year-old soldier again. So this patient also referred to us from eye clinic from August 2020. And when we saw the patient, so he also almost severe impairment of vision in left eye and right eye. He could count fingers. Right eye was significant impairment of vision was there. So what has happened is in 2018, 2 years ago, so he had some blurring in vision. It was overnight blur. At night, he had noticed some blurring of vision, and then in the morning he lost significant vision, and the other eye also involved 2 months later. So at that time he was diagnosed at panuveitis, and he was on oral steroids as well as various combinations of steroid sparing drugs as well. So he didn't have recurrent oral ulcer, but in 2015 he had oral ulcer which lasted for 2 weeks. So oral ulcers are very common, and so even the recurrent oral ulcers are common macroscopically and histologically, both resembles this patient's ulcers. But genital ulcers are significant. So 1 month before this, 1 month before getting this oral ulcer, so he had genital ulcer of 2 centimeters in diameter. And he also had oral ulcers twice, but not compatible with this criteria. That for this criteria, they need like 3 times per year, but he didn't fulfill this criteria to recurrent oral ulcers. But in 2018, he had positive MAN2. So after presenting with eye visual impairment, then treated with anti-TB. But after that, because TB QuantiFERON was negative, so they have stopped anti-TB, and his ESR was normal, and CARP, and everything was done. These were negative, and actually B51 also negative. So these were the ophthalmology notes. They mentioned like panuveitis, optic disc was failed, and fluorescent angiography, there was retinal vasculitis, and glaucoma also was present. So actually, so Behçet's, sometimes they can present even without recurrent genital ulcers or oral ulcers. So it's like ophthalmological diagnosis. So by looking at the retina, so there are specific changes to Behçet's. There's retinal vasculitis. Retinal vasculitis can involve veins, and there can be optic neuritis or these changes. So there are specific changes. Actually, eye surgeons, the expert eye surgeon's opinion is necessary to diagnose these ocular Behçet's. So this patient, so when he came to our clinic, so he also seen somewhere else, they have just queried because of this history of ulcers, they have queried whether it's Behçet's, but nobody has made the diagnosis of Behçet's. So when we saw the patient with the history of these genital ulcers and these ocular findings, we made the diagnosis of Behçet's, and we started him on adalimumab 40 milligram 2 weekly. So at first dose itself, he made some subjective improvement. So after 10 injections, now he can travel alone. He can read the boards in the buses, and so he can also see even with left eye there's some improvement. He can count fingers now. He can travel independently, and there's some improvement in vision, but it's very important for him. So there are EULA recommendations in 2018. So they mentioned like posterior uveitis. So we have to use high dose steroids with steroid pairing medication. So in veterans, they also get anterior uveitis. We know that this with hypopian with severe anterior uveitis present with hypopian, and these may not be like sight threatening. But if even if it is severe, we can start on steroids and steroid sparing medication even for anterior uveitis. But if there's posterior uveitis, need for steroids plus steroid sparing medication. But if there's sight threatening uveitis, the patient has to be on high dose steroids with either TNF inhibitors, infliximab or adalimumab or interferon. So there's great caution is needed to recognize and evaluate and monitor to assess effectiveness. So these guidelines say mentioned how to treat for articular manifestations, mucocutaneous and other manifestations as well. So other manifestations for Behçet's, so there can be nervous system involvement, but not peripheral nerves. So this nervous system involvement can be due to parenchymal or non-parenchymal, like due to thrombosis and other in other involvement. So GI Behçet's, it's difficult to differentiate from inflammatory bowel disease. So the inflammatory bowel disease also, they get recurrent oral ulcers, and there can be various skin manifestation. So ulcers also may be difficult to differentiate. So before making the diagnosis of Behçet's, intestinal involvement, you have to exclude inflammatory bowel disease. So take-home message is not to ignore oral ulcers, particularly when there are other features of Behçet's, when there are genital ulcers or other skin manifestation, and there's need for prompt immune suppression to prevent permanent damage. Thank you very much for listening, and thank you. And now Dr. Dilmi Somathilaka to present on young sailor's voyage to save his life. Over to you, Dilmi.
Thank you, madam. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Dilmi Somathilaka, Senior Registrar in Rheumatology at National Hospital of Sri Lanka. My topic for today is young sailor's voyage to save his legs. So let's see what the story is all about. So Mr. B is a 24-year-old unmarried gentleman from Ekala, and he works as a seaman. He was apparently well before when he first presented with worsening burning type of pain over the bilateral feet in the end of September 2020. Within a few days, he also developed numbness of left foot, which progressed to involve right foot within a day. And the numbness was up to the level of ankles. And over the course of a few days, he also felt numbness in both hands. The numbness was up to the level of wrists. Few days later, he also noticed painful erythematous papular rash over the medial aspect of his left big toe, left forefoot, and also over the left thenae minus as well. These patches coalesced and became blackish in color with time. He denied any significant weakness of the limbs. He denied any significant constitutional symptoms as well. There was no fever, no malaise, no loss of appetite or loss of weight. And he denied any arthralgia or myalgia. His urine output was as usual, without any excess froth or hematuria. There was no preceding history of Raynaud's phenomenon, any hyperviscosity symptoms, limb claudication, abdominal pain after meals, or any history suggestive of a thrombotic episode in the past. He was a non-smoker and an occasional beer consumer and denied any recreational drug abuse. There was no history of valvular heart disease or IV drug abuse in the past. He denied recurrent urogenital ulcers, alopecia, or photosensitivity. There was no proximal muscle weakness, finger swelling, or restricted mouth opening. The patient was a childhood asthmatic, but he was in remission for more than 10 years without using any treatment. He denied any recurrent episodes of allergic rhinitis, sinusitis, or hemoptysis. And he denied any high-risk sexual behavior or any past history of hepatitis or recurrent blood transfusions. There was no history of testicular pain or documented high blood pressure in the past. There was no recent history of forest trekking or tick bites. He denied any significant family history of young stroke or myocardial infarction, and he did not have any significant history of autoimmune connective tissue disease as well. So with all these ailments, he was admitted to the local hospital, and examination revealed an obese gentleman with a BMI of 27. He was afebrile. There was no pallor or plethora, no peripheral lymphadenopathy or ankle edema. And there was a necrotic blackish rash with surrounding erythema over the left thenae minus and also over the medial aspect of the left big toe and left foot. The picture I have shown here does not belong to our patient. So by the time he came to us, the rash had been completely settled. This picture I took from a case report where there was a similar presentation, and I thought this would tally with the description that our patient gave of his rash. His bilateral hands showed a low distal saturation of 89 to 90%, and bilateral feet showed a distal saturation of 85 to 87%. And his left dorsalis pedis pulse and right posterior tibial pulse were weak. Rest of the peripheral pulses were felt in the normal intensity, and there was no tenderness over the arteries. His cardiovascular system revealed a normal blood pressure, and heart examination showed normal sinus rhythm, and there were no audible murmurs. Respiratory system examination did not reveal any added sounds and was essentially normal. Interestingly, the nervous system examination did not reveal any demonstrable neurological deficit at the time of admission to the local hospital. Abdominal examination was also normal, and musculoskeletal system examination did not reveal any synovitis or enthesitis. So this young gentleman, who was apparently well before, is now having numbness of limbs, but there was no demonstrable objective neurological deficit. And he had a necrotic painful rash in the extremities and also weak distal pulses. So what were the possibilities? We thought of three main categories of differential diagnosis: vasculopathy with arterial thrombosis, embolic phenomenon, or vasculitis. So in the vasculopathy category, we considered antiphospholipid syndrome first. And secondly, we thought of other inherited thrombophilic conditions like protein C, NS deficiency, etc., although the patient did not give a preceding history of recurrent thrombotic episodes. We also considered the possibility of cold agglutinin disease, since the presentation was during the colder months of the year. And we also considered the possibility of myeloproliferative disease and hematological malignancies with prothrombotic state, although the patient denied significant constitutional symptoms in the history. Lastly, Burgess disease was also considered, although patient strongly denied tobacco consumption. embolic phenomena secondary to infective endocarditis. So valvular heart disease was also considered, all the although the cardiovascular system examination was normal. And a vasculitic process, either a primary or a secondary, was also thought of. And in the primary category, a small vessel vasculitis like ANCA-associated vasculitis or cryoglobulinemic vasculitis were given the priorities. And a medium vessel vasculitis like polyarthritis nodosa was also considered. And the secondary causes of vasculitis, like secondary to an autoimmune connective tissue disease like SLE, or secondary to an infection like rickettsial infection, and or a drug-induced vasculitis like cocaine, levosone-induced vasculitis, were also considered, although the patient strongly denied recreational drug use. Interestingly, over the course of few weeks, patient developed difficulty in walking, and there was clumsiness of hands as well. An examination revealed on the right-hand side there was weak intrinsic muscles supplied by the ulnar nerve with impaired pinprick over the medial 1.5 fingers. And on the left hand, there was weakness of lateral two lumbricals, opponent's pollicis, abductor pollicis brevis and plexi pollicis brevis supplied by the median nerve with impaired pinprick over the lateral 3.5 fingers. Bilateral feet did not demonstrate any weakness, but there was impaired pinprick over both soles. So the patient had a necrotic vasculitic rash and also had weak distal pulses and now having multiple nerve palsies as well. So we thought of narrowing down our differential diagnosis to these two possibilities because the differential diagnosis we considered under vasculopathic category do not commonly give rise to nerve palsies. So we thought of these two possibilities, either a small or medium vessel vasculitis with arterial thrombosis and mononeuritis multiplex, or is it a dual pathology, one etiology for the nerve involvement and separate etiology for the arterial involvement. So keeping those in mind, we proceeded with the investigations. And his arterial Doppler showed left-sided dorsalis pedis and distal anterior tibial nerve flow with acute thrombosis and right posterior tibial acute thrombosis as well. 2D echo did not demonstrate any evidence of infective endocarditis, so any valvular abnormalities. Interestingly, his WBC count was elevated. It was 15.8 with a eosinophil count of 7.4. Almost half of the total WBC count. Hemoglobin count was normal with normal red cell indices. Platelet count was also to the low side. Blood picture revealed severe eosinophilia with mild thrombocytopenia, but no abnormal cells were noted, which was followed by a bone marrow examination, which showed reactive marrow with no evidence of malignant infiltration. Hypereosinophilic syndrome gene detection by RT-PCR was also negative in this patient. His ESR was 22. CRP remained persistently elevated. Renal functions were essentially normal. UFR did not show any significant proteinuria or active sediments. Liver functions were also normal. Chest X-ray did not show any lung infiltrates. Ultrasound abdomen was also normal. His retroviral screening and hepatitis screening came as negative. Antinuclear antibodies, rheumatoid factor, and complement levels all were normal. And anticardiolipin and anti-beta-2 glycoprotein, IgM and IgG, both were negative. Interestingly, the ANCAs also came as negative, and the cryoglobulins also were negative. His skin punch biopsy taken from the left palm and the left foot showed small and medium vessel fibrin deposition and with endothelial swelling, as well as mural and perivascular infiltrate of eosinophils, scattered neutrophils, and also karyorrhectic debris. And there were a few poorly formed granulomas as well. The conclusion was a leukocytoplastic vasculitis. The nerve conduction study showed asymmetrical motor and sensory responses in upper limbs and lower limbs, suggestive of mononeuritis multiplex. His CSF analysis and the sural nerve biopsy came as negative. So what is the diagnosis? This gentleman has had a significant eosinophilia, more than 10%, and mononeuritis multiplex, and leukocytoplastic vasculitis with eosinophil infiltration and granulomas. The process was complicated by arterial thrombosis as well. So is it eosinophilic granulomatosis with polyangiitis? So according to ACR 1990 diagnostic criteria, it has six set of diagnostic criteria: asthma, paranasal sinusitis, eosinophilia more than 10%, lung infiltrates, histological proof, and also mononeuritis or peripheral polyneuropathy. So presence of four or more criteria yields a sensitivity of 85% and a specificity of 99.7%. Our patient scored only fulfilled only three criteria, and according to this 1990 ACR diagnostic criteria, and there is a new set of classification criteria laid down by the Diagnosis and Classification of Vasculitis study, and this criteria still awaits a final endorsement by ACR and EULA. This has a equal specificity and a like relatively high sensitivity compared to ACR criteria. So it has seven criteria. First five criteria scores plus points, and this last two criteria scores minus points. The criteria which scores plus points are the obstructive airway disease, nasal polyps, mononeuritis or mononeuritis multiplex, elevated eosinophil counts, or extravascular eosinophil predominant inflammation, or eosinophils in bone marrow. And the criteria which scores minus points are the C-ANCA positivity and microscopic hematuria. So a total score of 5 or higher is needed for the classification as EGPA, and our patient fulfilled 8 according to this classification criteria. So the patient was diagnosed to have EGPA. Management done at the local hospital was, he was started on subcut enoxaparin and later on converted to warfarin. And he was started on high dose prednisolone at a dose of 60 milligram, also along with acetabrin 50 milligram daily. So with this treatment, his skin rash settled and started peeling off, and eosinophil count came back to normal, and there was mild improvement in the numbness of the limbs. But his hand weakness was persistent, and the repeat arterial Doppler done at National Hospital showed worsening of arterial thrombosis. In fact, there was no flow in the right posterior tibial artery, and on the left side, most of the anterior tibial and popliteal arteries showed no flow with echogenic thrombus. So this patient warranted intensification of his immunosuppression and needed an intensive immunosuppressive regime. So the five factor score, which is, as the name implies, has five components in it. That is age more than 65, cardiac insufficiency, renal insufficiency, GI involvement, and absence of ENT manifestations. So this score is applied to systemic necrotizing vasculitis like EGPA, MPA, or polyarteritis nodosa at the time of diagnosis for the purpose of prognostication and as well as to decide on treatment regimes. So our patient had a five-factor score of more than one simply because of the absence of ENT manifestations. And he also had mononeuritis multiplex and also ongoing vessel inflammation and thrombosis. So he warranted immune induction, remission induction regime, and the patient was offered IV methylprednisolone 1 gram daily, 3 pulses, and given IV rituximab 500 milligram weekly, 4 pulses, and as he was a young male with fertility issues. Physiotherapy and occupational therapy for hand weakness was also arranged on him. He just received his fourth rituximab pulse this week, and with rituximab treatment, he had remarkable improvement in his weakness, hand weakness, and he is independent in his activities of daily living. Now he is able to feed himself and able to write as well. So how to offer maintenance therapy to this patient was a problem, because our patient is a seaman and he spends about 8 to 9 months a year on board before coming to land for his vacation. And most of the conventional immunosuppressives need regular monitoring of blood counts and liver functions when they are being given. So what can be offered to our patient? The most feasible option was rituximab pulses, usually recommended as 6 monthly injections, but at least we would be able to offer him 8 to 9 months at 8 to 9 month intervals. So the other option is to extend his medical leave and to start him on a conventional immunosuppressive regime. So the decision is still not taken. Patient is awaiting a clinic review next week. So talking a little bit about EGPA, according to 2012 revised International Chapel Hill Consensus Conference definition, it is eosinophil-rich and necrotizing granulomatous inflammation, often involving the respiratory tract, and necrotizing vasculitis predominantly affecting the small to medial vessels, which is associated with asthma. The disease has 3 main stages: a prodromal stage, eosinophil infiltrative phase, and a vasculitic phase. Prodromal phase is characterized by asthma, allergic rhinitis, and nasal polyposis. Eosinophil infiltrative phase is characterized by a peripheral eosinophilia with tissue inflammation. And the vasculitic phase has vasculitis with granulomatous inflammation causing systemic manifestations. The exact etiology of EGPA is still unknown, but it is believed to be due to an allergic or autoimmune response to either an environmental trigger or a drug. And the age of onset is between 15 to 70 years, with a mean age at 38 years. And there is equal incidence among males and females. So talking about the wide spectrum of clinical presentation, there are upper respiratory symptoms like allergic rhinitis, paranasal sinusitis, or nasal polyposis. Lower respiratory involvement is characterized by either asthma, pneumonitis with lung infiltrates, or hemoptysis secondary to alveolar hemorrhages. Cardiac involvement is in the form of myocarditis or myocardial infarction secondary to vasculitis. And the skin involvement, which occurs in about 60% of the patients, can be either a leukocytoclastic angiitis with palpable purpura or a livido reticularis type of a rash, and skin necrosis with gangrene, urticaria, or subcutaneous nodules also have been reported. Renal manifestations were in the form of either hypertension or glomerulonephritis, which are rare. And gastrointestinal manifestations are the GI bleeds, bowel ischemia and perforation, gastroenteritis, appendicitis, or pancreatitis. And nervous system involvement can be of 2 types, either peripheral neuropathy or a central nervous system involvement. Mononeuritis multiplex occurs in about 77% of the cases. And the central nervous system involvement in the form of stroke occurs in about 5% of the patients. So talking about EGPA and ANCA positivity, only a minority of patients with EGPA, that is about 30 to 50%, will have MPO ANCA positivity. There are 2 phenotypes according to ANCA positivity, the ANCA positive and the negative phenotypes. The positive phenotype has more vasculitic features with predominant mononeuritis, purpura, glomerulonephritis, and a frequently relapsing disease requiring higher doses of steroids. But the ANCA negative phenotype has more eosinophilic features like refractory asthma, lung infiltrates, and the cardiac involvement. So although these patients have fewer relapses, because of the cardiac involvement, they carry a poor prognosis. So EGPA without pulmonary symptoms, how common is it, like that occurred in our patient? Asthma is the central feature of EGPA and occurs in about 97% of the patients. And it is refractory and difficult to control asthma usually. Asthma may precede vasculitis by up to 10 to 12 years, or less frequently, they may coincide with the appearance of vasculitis as well. Paranasal sinusitis occurs in about 61% of the patients, and other pulmonary symptoms like cough and hemoptysis occur in about 37% of the patients. Although these respiratory symptoms are found in a majority of patients with EGPA, there are several reported cases without these symptoms, and the diagnosis of EGPA was basically made with the classical histological features of EGPA. So here are a few case reports like that. Patients have presenting without pulmonary symptoms. So talking about EGPA and thrombosis. So is it a common association? The prevalence of arterial thrombosis in ANCA-associated vasculitis is between 3.1 to 18.7%, and of venous thrombosis is between 5.8 to 30%. So out of all ANCA-associated vasculitis, EGPA has shown the highest incidence of thrombosis. The well-known theory of chronic ongoing inflammation causing increased atherothrombosis is a well-known fact. But apart from that, EGPA has several other specific mechanisms which drive prothrombotic state, and that is purely because of high eosinophil counts. Eosinophils secrete cationic proteins like major basic protein, eosinophilic cationic protein, and eosinophil peroxidases, which inhibit the natural anticoagulant factors like protein C and causes a prothrombotic state. And also, it secretes tissue factor. Eosinophils secrete tissue factor, and tissue factor goes and directly initiates the clotting cascade as well. So recent studies have shown that P-ANCA negative patients, like in our patient, tend to have much higher tissue infiltration by eosinophils and therefore carries a higher risk of thrombosis. There are several case reports stating that the arterial and venous thrombosis occurring in EGPA respond poorly to a heparin treatment because of a heparin inhibiting factor secreted by eosinophils. But these patients have reported to respond to rivaroxaban, which is a direct factor 10A inhibitor. But however, the cornerstone in management of thrombotic episodes in ANCA-associated vasculitis is aggressive immunosuppression rather than anticoagulation or antiplatelet treatment. Here are a few case reports of arterial and venous thrombosis occurring in patients with EGPA. So talking about management of EGPA, it's essentially a multidisciplinary approach, taking the support from the respiratory physician, the dermatologist, nephrologist, and also the physiotherapist, occupational therapist, all should contribute in the management of a patient. And the goal is to induce remission. Remission is defined as absence of clinical systemic manifestations, excluding ENT and manifestations and asthma, on a minimal dose of prednisolone and other immunosuppressive agents. So most of the randomized control trials done to assess the therapeutic options in ANCA-associated vasculitis have essentially excluded EGPA. So therefore, the therapeutic recommendations for EGPA are derived by extrapolation of above randomized control trial data as well as from small cohort studies done on EGPA patients. So management has two steps, remission induction and remission maintenance. The patients can be broadly categorized into two categories, patients with organ-threatening disease and patients with non-organ-threatening disease. So patients with organ-threatening disease, like patients having five-factor score of more than one, or having diffuse alveolar hemorrhages, eye involvement, or mononeuritis, require aggressive intravenous immunosuppressives for immune remission induction. And usually, very sick patients are offered IV methylprednisolone or else a high dose of oral prednisolone at a dose of 1 milligram per kg with gradual taper according to the clinical response. And the time-tested drug with best evidence is cyclophosphamide. It can be given as IV pulses at a dose of 15 milligram per kg, two weekly three pulses and 3 weekly three pulses. And the evidence comes from the Cyclops trial, which compared oral versus IV cyclophosphamide and found that both are equally efficacious in ANCA-associated vasculitis patients with renal involvement. But the IV form had lower cumulative doses of exposure and therefore less side effects such as cytopenias. And second option, if cyclophosphamide cannot be given to a patient because of the dreaded side effects like gonadal toxicity or hemorrhagic cystitis, the next option would be IV rituximab, which can be given at a dose of 375 milligram per square meter, weekly four pulses. And the evidence comes from the RAVE and the Rituximab trials. There is a new trial called RIOVAS currently underway, comparing rituximab versus standard treatment in remission induction in severe and non-severe HEPA patients. And the patients having less severe non-organ threatening disease, that is five factor score zero patients, can be managed with oral steroids alone. And then adding other immunosuppressive agents have not shown any added benefit in remission induction or maintenance according to the CHUSPAN trial. But in patients where the steroid dose cannot be tapered beyond 20 milligrams, right, might need steroid sparing agents in the management later on. So the maintenance therapy, the duration of maintenance is for 18 to 20 months at least. Best evidence is with rituximab, as the evidence comes from Menritsan 1 and Menritsan 2 trials. And the further extended courses of rituximab has shown to be beneficial, as evidenced by Menritsan 3 trial. And there is a new trial currently underway called Menritsech, which is comparing azathioprine versus rituximab in EGPA patients as maintenance therapy. So if rituximab is not available, the other options are azathioprine, methotrexate, or mycophenolate mofetil. And what is the place for plasma exchange in EGPA patients or any ANCA-associated vasculitis? There are no data to support its routine use according to the PEXIVAS and the MEPEX studies. And this should only be considered in patients with severe diffuse alveolar hemorrhages and rapidly progressive severe renal insufficiency. In this setting, the plasma exchange has attenuated the progression to end-stage renal disease and enhanced renal recovery and dialysis-free time duration at 12 months after a flare, but the long-term benefits were unclear. And what is the place for IVIG treatment in EGPA? There are several case reports demonstrating the efficacy of high-dose IVIG in naive as well as previously treated EGPA patients. In a small Japanese case series, EGPA-related heart involvement and peripheral neuropathy have shown to respond well to IVIG. And IVIG was a good option in EGPA patients during pregnancy as well. So talking about monitoring of EGPA patients, the monitoring should be essentially clinical, and the Birmingham Vasculitis Activity Score, BVAS score, can be used to monitor the disease activity. And the simple blood and urine investigations like ESR, CRP, and UFR will also help you in the process. Importantly, ANCA positivity or ANCA titers or the eosinophil counts should not be used to assess the disease activity or to detect a relapse. The definition of a relapse is the new appearance, recurrence, or worsening of clinical manifestations, excluding asthma or ENT manifestations, requiring addition, change, or dose increase of steroids and other immunosuppressive agents. So ANCA positivity and low eosinophil count at the time of diagnosis and cutaneous manifestations were predictive of higher relapse rates. So talking a little bit about novel therapies in EGPA, mepolizumab, which is an anti-IL-5 antibody. So this IL-5 stimulates the proliferation, activation, and survival of eosinophils. So mepolizumab inhibits this eosinophilic activity. and this gained FDA approval in 2017 to be used in refractory or relapsing EGPA patients, and the evidence comes from the MERA trial. Racilizumab, an anti-IL-5 antibody, and benralizumab, which is an antibody against IL-5 receptor alpha, are still in the process of like phase 2 trials, are still underway, whether they can be used in the management of EGPA. Omalizumab, which is an anti-IgE antibody, blocking IgE binding to mast cells can reduce the recruitment and activation of eosinophils by inhibiting the type 2 helper response. So this drug has shown to help control asthma and reduce steroid requirement in EGPA patients in a small study done with 18 patients. So in summary, EGPA is a syndrome with a wide spectrum of clinical manifestations. Histological assessment plays a key role in the diagnosis. Poorly controlled disease can lead to organ and life-threatening complications. An early aggressive treatment in patients with severe organ-threatening disease can prevent disability. These are my references. I would like to acknowledge the help and guidance given by my trainer, Dr. Monica Di Silva, consultant rheumatologist NHSL, and Dr. Bhimsarasena Nayaka, consultant neurologist NHSL, and Dr. Saman Vijayathunga, consultant physician, DGH Nigambo, Dr. Dilrukshi Tenakon, consultant rheumatologist, DGH Nigambo, and Dr. Premini Rajendran, consultant dermatologist, DGH Nigambo, and to all my colleagues as well. Thank you.
So this is the end of our presentations, and because we are running short of time, I think there's no time for questions. And thank you for participation, and we'll have next meeting on 5th of February. Thank you.